shall love the Lord your God, and love your neighbor as yourself. Good morning and welcome to worship here with Union Presbyterian Church. My name is Pastor Andy, and I am delighted to lead you in worship this morning. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for planting in us the seed of your word. By your Holy Spirit, help us to receive it with joy and live according to it, that we may grow in faith and hope and love through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. The proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin. Holy and merciful God, in your presence we confess our failure to be what you created us to be. You alone know how often we have sinned in wandering from your ways, in wasting your gifts, in forgetting your love. By your loving mercy, help us to live in your light and abide in your ways, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Savior. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone, a new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Our scripture this morning is from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 10, verses 1 through 2. Listen now for the word of our Lord. Ah, you who make iniquitous decrees, who write oppressive statutes, to turn aside the needy from justice, and to rob the poor of my people of their right, that widows may be your spoil, and that you may make the orphans your prey. I'll stop there. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. The passage from Isaiah I just read is a warning against those who write unjust ordinances, who create laws which are unfair to the poor. This morning, I would like to examine an idea that you may have heard quite a lot about recently on the news and in your readings. It's the idea of systemic racism. Oftentimes, when we think about racism, we think about individuals with racial animus. That is, we think about individuals who have made a point in hating people of a different race. Or we think about persons who are prejudiced against black people, who make assumptions about the abilities and the motives of people of color. Or we even think about our own hidden and subtle biases. Certainly those are all examples of racism, but those are examples of racism that focus on each one of us as an individual. Lately, there's been more attention paid to what is called systemic racism. That is, the racism that exists outside of each of us as individuals, but rather which resides within the systems of our society. Now, personally, for me, this has been a difficult idea to grasp. People will talk about systemic racism, and people will talk about dismantling systemic racism in ways as though it were obvious what people were referring to, as though there were some kind of machinery at the edge of town that we could apply our wrenches to disassemble. And yet, no such machinery is clearly visible. So I've struggled to learn and to understand this concept, and I'm hoping that what I came up with will help you also understand systemic racism and how it is we might go about dismantling it, to use the verbiage of the hour. For me, things become real when they happen in the spatial and temporal world. In other words, I'm at heart a geographer. Things are real when they happen on the earth. And so this morning, with our conversation about systemic racism, I want to focus on the geography of systemic racism in northern cities such as Minneapolis and St. Paul, and even later, a wee bit on St. Peter. We tend to think of segregation as having been a southern phenomenon, a phenomenon of the South within the United States, of places like Mississippi and Alabama and Georgia. But spatial segregation, that is the segregation of the races geographically by neighborhood, also happened here in our northern cities. It happened here in Minnesota, in Minneapolis, in St. Paul. The mechanism of northern segregation was different, or is different, than the mechanisms of southern segregation during Jim Crow, but the impacts of northern segregation were equally hurtful. So I want to describe to you how it is that northern urban segregation came about as an example of systemic racism, and then show how that kind of segregation hurts black people and continues to this day. The story of northern urban racial segregation begins with housing covenants. A century ago, in cities like Minneapolis and St. Paul, also Chicago and Milwaukee and Detroit, housing covenants made it impossible for non-Caucasians to move into middle-class neighborhoods. These covenants were written into property deeds, and they stipulated that a particular residential property, a particular house, a particular parcel of land, could never be sold to a non-Caucasian person, to a non-white person. These restrictions said something like this. So you could get out your property deed, and to this day in many houses in Minneapolis or St. Paul, you could get out your actual property deed, and it might include language that would read, "Premises shall not be sold, mortgaged, or leased to or occupied by any person or persons other than members of the Caucasian race." Here is an advertisement on your screen from 1923 for a then new Lake Nokomis area housing development in South Minneapolis. These houses in this neighborhood were not to be sold to non-white people. You can even see a depiction of a white family in the lower right-hand corner of the advertisement. So these covenants, and they even use that theological language, which is doubly unfortunate, but these covenants made it impossible for black people to move into these new middle-class neighborhoods. While such discriminatory covenants are now against the law, thanks to Supreme Court decisions, Many middle-class urban neighborhoods were established for white people, and the pattern continued. Now, things have changed. In this Lake Nokomis neighborhood today, about 80% of the people who live there are white, and about 20% are not white, if you will. So the pattern overall has persisted, although there has been some increased diversity. So the housing covenants of the past were made illegal by Supreme Court decisions. But one thing that has remained roughly the same from 100 years ago are zoning laws. Now, you all know that I am the chair of the Planning and Zoning Commission here in St. Peter, so I am critiquing something that I'm quite familiar with here in our own city. Beginning in the early 1900s, zoning laws in cities and suburbs made it illegal to build small, affordable houses in affluent, that is to say, white areas. A zone might stipulate that houses had to be on lots of a certain minimal size, with setbacks from the street of a certain distance, and there are often requirements for large, grassy, expensive grass lawns, all mandated by law. Now, large, single-family detached housing lots make for expensive housing. And expensive housing is housing that many black people cannot afford. Apartments above shops, such as what we have downtown St. Peter, were also made illegal by zoning ordinances, except for those which already existed. These sorts of apartments are affordable and are close to sources of employment and shopping. So people who live there don't necessarily need to drive as often or as far to get to their workplace or to area shops. Other traditional sources of low-income housing, such as boarding houses, were also made illegal in most urban zoning codes. In most neighborhoods in our city and in urban areas across the United States, constructing multi-unit residential buildings is prohibited by law. For example, here is the official zoning map for St. Peter. Union Presbyterian Church is located in an R2 zone. Only single-family or two-family housing units are allowed in an R2 zone, plus some other uses such as churches and birthing centers. It would be illegal to build a multi-unit apartment building in this church neighborhood. Furthermore, zoning codes separate residential, commercial, and industrial areas. Therefore, we Americans have to commute from home and to work and to shop. Travel is expensive. Public transportation is limited and difficult, so most American families have to own a car or two. Cars are wonderful for people who can afford them, but they are a significant financial drain for everyone and a real financial liability that hurts poor people who are more likely to be black. These laws make home ownership and travel to work and commerce prohibitive for poor people, for black people. In effect, these zoning laws keep most black families out of affluent and middle-class white neighborhoods. These laws are still in the books today, as you know, and are zealously defended across the political spectrum. Some cities which have made attempts to upzone, meaning to allow for more flexibility in housing, such as allowing fourplexes or threeplexes in R2s and R1s, have faced considerable pushback. Minneapolis did recently upgrade their zone to allow for more dense housing, but it took an immense amount of political effort, even in that liberal city. So these zoning laws are supported by people from across the political spectrum, even though they have a disproportionately negative effect on poor and black people. Another factor in the way in which urban cities became segregated is redlining. I'm sure you've heard of redlining recently. In the 1930s, during the midst of the Great Depression, the federal government sought to make home ownership more affordable for families. The Homeowners Loan Corporation of 1933 and the Federal Housing Administration of 1934 created affordable long-term mortgages. Before the 1930s in these federal programs, loans were entirely private. It was just a loaner borrowing, just a bank loaning money to the borrower, and terms were often less than 5 years, and interest rates were much higher. So these government programs, with the structuring of these 20 and 30 year mortgages and the government backing of these mortgages, helped many poor and middle class people achieve their American dream of property ownership. However, the government produced maps to indicate loan risk by neighborhood. Affluent and white areas were deemed to be low risk areas, while poor and black neighborhoods were colored in red to indicate that these areas were high risk, too high risk for new government-backed loans. In effect, this made home ownership cheap and easy for white people and nearly impossible for black people. Thanks to cheap credit, white neighborhoods prospered and grew. And due to a lack of credit and federal discrimination, entire black neighborhoods remained underdeveloped and poor. Although redlining is illegal today, the decades of underinvestment in poor and black neighborhoods continues to affect the wealth and well-being of people who live in these neighborhoods. After the war, that is the Second World War, many veterans came home to build a stable middle-class life thanks to the GI Bill. In part, like the government programs of the 1930s, the GI Bill made low-interest housing mortgages available for new mass-produced suburbs. Although the GI Bill did not contain racially restrictive language, it was typically administrated with great preference for white veterans. Historian Ira Kens Nelson notes that in New York and the northern New Jersey suburbs, fewer than 100 of the 67,000 mortgages insured by the GI Bill supported home purchases by non-whites. Let me read that again. Fewer than 100 of the 67,000 home mortgages underwritten by the GI Bill went to non-whites in the East Coast. The administration of the GI Bill widened the racial wealth gap as billions of federal dollars created an all-white suburban middle class, leaving black people behind. Meanwhile, in the cities, in the 1960s, federal and local governments bulldozed urban slums and constructed large, vertical, modernist public housing units in urban centers. These housing towers destroyed communities, concentrated poverty, and did almost nothing to promote black wealth. Furthermore, after the Second World War, President Eisenhower envisioned an interstate highway system that would connect American cities. He copied this idea of an interstate from Germany, from the Autobahn. Now, in Germany, the Autobahn connects ring roads that encircle cities, leaving urban centers intact. However, in the United States, interstates were built through cities so that white suburbanites could commute quickly to their jobs downtown. And often, the construction of these interstates through cities destroyed black and integrated neighborhoods. while typically avoiding wealthy white urban neighborhoods. Famously, the Rondo neighborhood in St. Paul was a lively multi-ethnic and multi-racial neighborhood of immigrants and African Americans who were migrating from the South, located east of the state capital in St. Paul. I-94 bisected and destroyed the heart of Rondo, even though an alternative path for the interstate along the railroad lines to the north was possible. Interstates made commuting easier for white suburbanites, but they destroyed racially integrated and black communities. Now, part of the process of suburbanization was the process of creating new municipalities, new cities. So we talk about the twin cities as though there are only two, but in fact there are dozens of cities and municipalities in the metropolitan region. There's Burnsville and Apple Valley and Mapleton and Maple Grove and all sorts of places. South St. Paul, East St. Paul, North St. Paul, all the Maples. Did I get the Maples? Around the metropolitan area, Shoreview. There's so many, I can't remember all their names. Each of those cities is an independent city with its own property taxes, its own school systems, its own police departments, its own fire departments, and those services are funded by local sales taxes, property and property taxes. Each of those cities has captured a portion of the total wealth of the Twin Cities area, wealth created by these 1930s and post-war federal programs. They've captured that wealth and they use that wealth to benefit the citizens who happen to live within those boundaries. Meanwhile, the school systems and the police systems and the public services of Minneapolis and St. Paul, which still contain the bulk of the population of poorer people, struggle with fewer resources. A perfect example of this is Edina, which is adjacent to South Minneapolis. Edina has a much higher per capita income and a much higher amount of wealth than does the city of Minneapolis. And yet, if you drive from one neighborhood to another between Edina and Minneapolis, you're in the same city. You know, we're in the same metropolitan area, and yet we've divided up our tax base such that wealthy people tax themselves for their own schools, and poor municipalities struggle to maintain adequate systems for a broader population. So even though the process of suburbanization has slowed, those municipal boundaries have captured inequalities. Now, despite all those injustices through history, you might be wondering why people of color, why black people, why black Americans didn't just move from their underinvested urban neighborhoods to smaller communities outside of the Twin Cities. After all, the cost of housing is much lower in small towns, and there are often good jobs in rural communities. However, officially and unofficially, there are what we call today sundown towns. A sundown town is a community that for decades kept non-whites from living in it and was thus all white on purpose. Some allowed a non-white household or two as an exception. Beginning in about 1890 and continuing until 1968, white Americans established thousands of towns across the United States for whites only. Many towns drove out their black populations, then posted sundown signs at the city edge. Others passed laws barring African Americans after dark, or prohibited them from owning or renting property. Still others just harassed and even killed those who violated the custom. Some sundown towns also kept out Jews, Chinese, Mexicans, Native Americans, and other groups. And I'm quoting from a website about sundown towns there. Now, I don't know whether or not St. Peter was a sundown town. It's not listed on this website as being one. It would require some research to go back and look at the city code and to talk to witnesses to see that tradition was here in St. Peter. But the effect is the same. Many people who lived in poor urban areas did not feel welcomed to move to rural areas. Even today, I have a number of friends who are black pastors, and they feel that they would not be welcomed to move to small town Minnesota, to small town America, to lead a church there. I think it's unfortunate that we've created a culture where black people don't feel safe in communities that would offer affordable housing and good jobs. Many of these racist policies that formed our segregated cities and communities are now illegal. Housing covenants, redlining, both of those are illegal. It would be politically impossible nowadays to construct a new interstate highway through a city now. And in fact, some cities are even slowly removing their interstates from their urban centers. Culturally, we still have something of the idea that some places aren't really meant for black people. Or if we see a black person or a black family in certain neighborhoods or certain communities, they stand out. We sort of culturally think, that person doesn't belong here, although attitudes are changing. On the other hand, some of these policies and government structures remain in place, and these structures helped maintain wealth disparities. As I showed you, zoning ordinances that prohibit high density housing and mandate large grassy lawns, which make housing prohibited for poor people, continue to artificially drive up housing costs for all Americans, which especially hurts poor people and black people. The Twin Cities is still and may forever remain a morass of dozens of municipalities, although the Metropolitan Council, which is a pan-governmental institution, does what it can to lessen some of those disparities and to coordinate transportation and planning. The result of these policies is that the wealth gap, which is about 10 times for white people than it is for black people, that is, the median wealth of a white family is approximately 10 times the median wealth of a black family in America today, but that ratio is greater than what it was 10, 20, 30 years ago. The gap in wealth between racial groups is increasing. And so this pattern that we see of things having once been illegal, or once being legal, now being made illegal through Supreme Court decisions or changes in laws, but the pattern that those racist laws continues to the present, oftentimes even in structures such as municipal boundaries or zoning ordinances. So this is a common theme in that we have very few, if any, explicitly racist laws on the books, but the pattern, the institutions that those racist laws created continues to produce racist results. Our culture is much less deliberately racist than we were a century ago. People's beliefs and attitudes have changed tremendously. Yet the institutions that we created over the past century continue to produce increasing disparities. We need to create the kind of communities that will allow black people to create wealth. Thus, we need to reimagine what our communities look like. We need to reimagine what St. Peter looks like. Not just in terms of the color of the skin or the style of the dress of the citizens of St. Peter, but we also need to reconsider what St. Peter looks like in its structure, in its zoning, in its planning, and the prevalence of single family detached housing, small houses and large houses, and perhaps the presence of additional affordable multifamily residential units, and considerations of, perhaps we can build housing that is closer to the commercial areas of town and to industry. We need new planning and zoning schemes that allow for poor people to own residential property near their workplaces and favorite stores so that they can spend less money on rent, less money on cars, and more of their income on building wealth. I think that is the first time I preached on zoning ordinances. I don't know if that was as exciting for you as for me, but to me, it shows the depth of this problem of racism. It's not just about attitudes. It's not just about how we feel about ourselves as white people and our feelings of white shame and guilt and all that kind of stuff. It's about laws. It's about sidewalks and streets and interstates. It's about setbacks and housing and alleys and duplexes and apartment buildings. It's about how we as citizens in a democracy structure the places we live through the democratic process. It is about the communities that we produce and the wealth that those kinds of communities create for what kinds of people and under what circumstances. Above all, my vision and the vision of Scripture is for a city that serves all people, for a city that is just to the poor, that is just to the widow, that is just to people of all kinds of race and ethnicity and cultures and backgrounds. Our dream is of a St. Peter that is accessible for everyone, where everyone can thrive in our town. Our dream is of a Minneapolis and of a St. Paul, of a twin cities of all the various municipalities that work together to promote a fullness and richness of life, of multicultural, multi-ethnic, multiracial life for all persons in those communities. And in order to do that, we have to confront systemic racism. I've enjoyed sharing that with you, and I want to thank this morning Jonathan, who's been putting so much volunteer effort into creating these sermons. He invited me to include maps in some of my sermons, so I took up the challenge, and I appreciate his encouragement and the work he has put into making these videos for you to watch. His expertise in all things internet and computer and graphic has been a great resource for this church in this time, and I greatly appreciate it, especially today. I want to lift up your prayer concerns. I want to pray for Bob and Jean Nelson as Bob fell. Prayers for his recovery. Prayers for members of this community who continue to deal with kids at home and struggle to find ways to recreate and enjoy this summer. By and large, most people are doing pretty well. I'm glad to hear that. Our Tuesdays under the picnic shelter that Paul Biederman made many years ago is now getting good use. Paul, I hope you hear this. The men's breakfast is going well. And I want to say that in August, and the date is slipping my mind right now, we will be having an outdoor church service in August at the Minnesota Square Park. So pay attention to that. I'll have more actual details later for you. But put that on your mental calendar. But I want to pray for this church, and I want to pray for you. Let us pray the way that Jesus taught us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's now stand and sing a hymn together. Well, my friends, another Sunday has come and another Sunday closer to when we can be reunited in this beautiful sanctuary. For now, go now in peace to love God, love others, and serve the world.